According to our current understanding of the universe, minuscule quantum fluctuations in the first moments after the Big Bang is how anything exists at all. It's why the universe is not filled with a homogeneous fog of hydrogen and helium atoms, but instead, these fluctuations planted seeds, so to speak, variations in energy density, and so atoms could fall towards each other, while otherwise, they would simply be evenly spread out, and there would be no structures. No clusters, no galaxies, just particles floating without ever interacting. Now, this is one of the most fascinating and bizarre things I've ever learned about the history of the universe. Now, you can say nobody really knows what it was actually like at the very first moments of existence, and you wouldn't be wrong, but there is a proper mathematical foundation for all of this, so at the end of the day, I'm gonna trust the people who do a lot of complicated math for a living. Billions of years later, these tiniest of fluctuations made that on some small planet orbiting a small yellowish star, a bunch of strange nude apes with big heads invented telescopes to look into space with. Okay, the whole ordeal is a lot more complicated than that, but still, we get to be alive in a time where we already know so much about the universe. And yeah, you can definitely argue it's probably still not that much, but we're getting there. With the naked eye, we can see a couple thousand stars in the night sky. With a good pair of binoculars or a small telescope, thousands more, and with any big telescope or a space telescope, many millions. Stars were long shrouded in mystery. We simply didn't have the means to learn much about them, but our ways of learning more about the cosmos improve all the time. Quantum fluctuations at the beginning of time is how stars can exist. And because stars can exist, we can exist. The Big Bang resulted in clouds of hydrogen and helium atoms, the simplest atoms that can form, and over time, these clouds collapsed in on themselves. The intense pressure and temperature inside got so high that nuclear fusion of hydrogen atoms into helium atoms started to happen, and the first stars lit up the darkness. They were likely absolutely humongous and short-lived, and their end must have been completely spectacular to witness. These first stars and their extremely violent ends forged brand new atoms, like carbon and oxygen, elements that are essential for life as we know it. We live in an age of the universe that star formation is still going on all around us. We live in a galaxy with tons of active star-forming regions all around us. Some of them are visible to the naked eye, like the famous Orion Nebula in the constellation of the same name. With this cavity carved out by the intense stellar winds of the hot and massive blue stars at the center. The Tarantula Nebula in the Large Magellanic Cloud, a small, irregular satellite galaxy of the Milky Way. It's the brightest star-forming region in the local universe. And the Carina Nebula, one of the largest nebula visible in the night sky, home to the so-called Mystic Mountain, and this funny little nebula nicknamed the Defiant Finger, or the Finger of God. Though I don't think many people really call it that. It wouldn't be a very good sign from God anyway. With extremely sensitive instruments like space telescopes, astronomers are able to closely study regions in space where stars form. And as a bonus, these are some of the most beautiful images of the cosmos. Stars are born inside these nebula in space. Immense clouds of gas and dust, made up of mostly hydrogen and helium, and trace amounts of heavier elements forged in the hearts of stars long dead, or from collisions of stellar remnants like white dwarfs or neutron stars. The Eagle Nebula, some 5,700 light-years away, is home to some of the most famous star-forming regions, including the so-called Pillars of Creation in the heart of the nebula. In the head of the tallest pillar, we can see these small dark protrusions. These are named evaporating gaseous globules, or eggs for short. Eggs are believed to be the predecessors of protostars, and star formation inside these globules may be triggered by the strong stellar winds coming from nearby massive stars. The high energy winds stir and compress the gas and dust, and so the clouds can begin to collapse. Another way star formation can begin is from the shockwave of a nearby supernova explosion. But even without such events, the cold gas and dust inside these clouds tends to clump and collide until protostars start to develop. Less famous but still gorgeous is a sibling of the Pillars of Creation, the Fairy in the Eagle Nebula. This cloud towers some 9.5 light years or 90 trillion kilometers, and in its head we can spot more eggs as the blast of a star cluster in the Eagle eats away the less dense parts of the cloud. These globules seem small, but in reality are roughly the size of our solar system. Another well-known image is this one of the so-called cosmic cliffs, found in the Carina Nebula some 7,500 light-years away. This is one of the first images taken by the James Webb Space Telescope, an extremely advanced machine that sits out in space to help us study the universe. Webb is an infrared telescope, meaning it mostly captures low-energy light moving through space in low wavelengths. Infrared light. In this older picture of the cosmic cliffs from Hubble Space Telescope, which images space in near-infrared, visible in higher-energy ultraviolet light, it's obvious why deep infrared imaging is so helpful. It makes that scientists can find objects that can't be seen in visible light, since the dust in nebula absorbs a lot of radiation coming from stars inside them. To Hubble, the cliffs look dark and opaque, but with Webb, we can peer through the dust. Just in this little head on top of the cliffs, we can already see dozens more stars, and studying the universe in all wavelengths of light is how we can know so much about it. And just to put things into perspective, this image of cosmic cliffs spans 16 light years, and zooming in on that little head and this seemingly small star here off the side, let me show you what our solar system would look like if it would be in there. Truly tiny. And see how far our furthest machine from Earth has gotten. I really want to believe that someday we or some other intelligent species will figure out interstellar travel, but images like this make me wonder if space simply isn't too big. There seem to be these hypothetical loopholes in the limitations of light speed, but so far it doesn't look like anybody's cracked the code, and we and whoever else is out there might just be stuck in our own star systems. But who knows, there's still a lot of questions that we don't have an answer for. The heart of the Carina Nebula is filled with all sorts of fascinating objects, giant hot stars, some at the end of their lives, open star clusters, and numerous clumps of gas and dust where new stars are being formed. This Hubble image from 2010 looks straight out of a dream, but this mystic mountain is being eroded away by the searing light coming from nearby massive stars, and is shaped and sculpted by the scorching winds, streams of charged particles coming from super-hot newborn stars within the nebula. These winds stir the gas and dust that forms this 3-light-year-tall pillar, causing parts of it to collapse into more new stars. To the left side and at the top, we can see long streams of gas ejected by protostars from inside their dusty cocoons. Now, observations like these is how we can get an idea of how stars can form. There's no way to follow a star from the moment it's born to the moment it dies, because stars shine for many billions of years. What we can do is study stars all around us in different stages of their lives and piece together how they're born, live, and end. You can compare it to being given one day to walk around a forest and looking at tall, mature trees, younger trees, dead trees, saplings, and seeds. And so you could probably guess how trees come to be. And you might also be full of wonder and amazement about how small seeds can grow into so many stunningly beautiful things. Protostars are the earliest phase of star formation, when a dense enough cloud of gas and dust contracts and forms an opaque core. Most of the gas and dust falls into this core. What remains gathers into an orbit around the forming star, as the whole system spins and cools. The leftover gas flattens and becomes a so-called protoplanetary disk. This phase lasts a few tens of millions of years, and the formation of the disk only 1 million years, which is peanuts on the cosmic timescale. Once it's there, it changes quickly. For the next few million years, tiny, dusty, and icy grains and specks rotating in the disk collide and clump together, forming marble-sized bits, and these marbles come together into larger and larger chunks, until planetoids between 100 and 1,000 kilometers in diameter have formed. This process continues until proper planets emerge. Close to the star, planets are rocky and metallic, but further out, ice and gas can persist and planets can grow into gas giants. Just before proper stable nuclear fusion begins, some protostars can already send out huge amounts of energy while they continue to contract and build pressure and heat inside. In this image from Hubble, we can see a baby star throwing a tantrum, so to speak. The young star itself still sits obscured in its dusty nest, but the colorful jets blasted out to the bottom left in this picture is a 10-light-year-long burst of gas, dust, and charged particles. These jets may be caused by the strong magnetic fields of the protostar, or from material falling into the core, or both. Astronomers suspect that our sun may have looked just like this when it was first forming about 4.6 billion years ago. The Earth, with all its inhabitants, from you and me, every tree and bird and ant and blade of grass, and all the tiny bacteria in the soil and on your skin, all the neurons firing in every brain right now, come from that disk of dust that didn't fall into the hot core of the proto-sun as it was collapsing, possibly triggered by the shockwave from a nearby supernova. And that is simply incredible to think about. This spectacular image from the Webb telescope of a protostar shows twin jets glowing bright pink and ghostly blue, while the forming star is once again hidden by the cloud from which it is being born. This baby star sits only about 1,000 light years away from Earth, making it a great object for study of this early phase of star formation. It's no older than a few tens of thousands of years, with only 8% the mass it will likely have once it's a fully formed star similar to our sun. In this other breathtaking image from Webb, some of the dust has cleared and the light of two newly born stars is revealed, while the bursts of their birth still echo in the pink jets. It seems that most stars form in pairs, and these will in time become low-mass stars much like our sun. Maybe in a few billion years, living beings might enjoy a sunset just like the one from George Lucas's famous movie franchise. This vivid Webb image is not only amazing to look at, it also confirmed something astronomers had long assumed but never had hard evidence for. As clouds collapse to form stars, the stars will tend to spin in the same direction. As a gas cloud crashes in on itself to form a star, it spins faster. The only way for the gas to continue moving inward is for some of the spin, known as angular momentum, to be removed. The swirling magnetic fields in the inner disk formed around the protostar launch some of the material into twin jets that shoot outward in opposite directions, perpendicular to the disk of material. Here in the top left corner, we can see several protostellar jets are all aligned, meaning scientists have been correct in their assumption. Only 460 light-years away, this complex of interstellar clouds is one of the closest star-forming regions to our planet, home to about 50 young stars, all of them similar in mass to the Sun or smaller. The pale, milky hollow in the middle is caused by the most massive star in the cloud, as its blazing stellar winds have carved out its own glowing cave of dust. The top of this image is dominated by denser, darker clouds, and the deep red wisps of protostellar outbursts. All of these images allow us to study a very brief period in the stellar life cycle. Nebula like these last only a moment on a cosmic timescale, and the dust quickly disperses into space, and the stellar cocoons are blown away or fall into the star, and just a handful of it forms planets. Maybe on some of those planets, beings who can admire the universe like we can will exist sooner or later, dedicating their fleeting time to gathering knowledge and teaching each other. Even if that may seem pointless, because there are no guarantees for the future. There are lifetimes like mayflies on Earth, alive for just one day, just one sunrise and sunset, before the inevitable end. There may be blue skies on that day, or rain, or a rare flash of lightning. There may be the shade below the trees, there may be open grassland, or the whispers of running water. All of it so, so beautiful in the light of the nearest star. This time in our universe's history is full of the fireworks of starbirth, and we get to be here to witness it. No matter how brief our existence is, there's something miraculous about the fact we can see and study stars and the origins of life on our planet, and consciously understand these things. So maybe that's something to keep in mind next time you come across a beautiful image of space. Thank you for watching. I hope you learned something new today, and I will see you soon. Cat. Hi. Okay.